Tonight is Apple in talks to buy Beats headphones. VCs tell the FCC they want net neutrality. And Uber is under attack again. Tech News Tonight is next.
This is TWiT.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 83 for Thursday, May 8th, 2014. I'm Sarah Lane, and let's get right into the tech feed with some breaking news. The Financial Times is reporting that Apple is close to completing an acquisition of the headphone company Beats Electronics. Since then, Bloomberg, The Wall Street Journal, and The New York Times have confirmed via tweets and articles that Apple is, in fact, at least in talks with Beats over a possible acquisition. Sources tell the Financial Times that Apple will acquire Beats' streaming music service as well, which launched earlier this year, and its audio equipment business, which includes both headphones and audio equipment. Apple is said to be paying $3.2 billion for the service, and the Beats management team will report to CEO Tim Cook. For what it's worth, Apple and Beats are both declining to comment. Yesterday, we told you a group of major tech companies filed a protest with the FCC in opposition to proposed net neutrality rules that the commission is set to publish on May 15th, a week from today. Today, a group of venture capitalists who invest in the tech sector also published an open letter to the FCC warning that the end of net neutrality would be a blow to startups. The letter argues, quote, if established companies are able to pay for better access speeds or lower latency, the internet will no longer be a level playing field, and startups with applications that are advantaged by speed, such as games, video, or payment systems, will be unlikely to overcome that deficit, no matter how innovative their service. So May 15th is a week away, but two commissioners at the FCC itself, Republican Commissioner Ajit Pai and Democrat Jessica Rosenworcel, are calling on the agency to delay its plans to implement new network neutrality rules amidst the backlash. FCC Chairman Tom Wheeler has said that the new rules won't lead to internet fast lanes, but if he's pressured to delay, it remains to be seen if the rules change substantially, either by reclassifying broadband or another route all together. In a House Judiciary Committee meeting today, lawmakers grilled executives from Comcast and Time Warner Cable on how the company's proposed $45 billion merger deal would help consumers. Comcast has said previously that consumers should not expect price cuts if the deal is approved by federal regulators. Comcast Executive Vice President David Cohen said higher costs of programming, particularly for sporting events, are mostly the reason for those high monthly cable bills, but also said a combined company would offer, quote, a significantly improved customer experience for Time Warner subscribers. I'm sorry, I just have to laugh at that. With faster internet speeds and more programming choices. Several lawmakers also raised concerns about how a deal would impact the Hispanic television market, since the combined company would operate in areas serving more than 90% of Hispanic households. Cohen pointed out that the company currently airs 58 channels of Spanish language programming, including 8 channels from Univision. Amazon is bringing Sunday delivery to more than 15 more cities in 7 states, such as Columbus, Ohio, Dallas, Texas, and Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, which expands an arrangement with the U.S. Postal Service to deliver Amazon packages on Sundays that launched last year in L.A. and New York. Mike Roth, Amazon's Vice President of North America Operations, said in a press release that the most common items delivered on Sunday include baby supplies, such as newborn apparel, books, and toys. Sunday delivery is clearly crossing errands off the weekend to-do list. The company has been working to reduce the amount of time between a customer's order and product delivery, also by expanding its same-day delivery program, and reportedly is testing its own last-mile shipping service. Samsung announced today that its head of mobile design team, Chang Dong-hoon, offered to resign last week and will be replaced by Lee Min-hyuk, vice president for mobile design, amid criticism of the latest Galaxy S smartphone. The S5 debuted globally last month, but received criticism from some consumers due to lack of hardware innovation and plastic case design. Chang will stay with the company and continue to lead Samsung's design center, which oversees its overall design strategy. In San Francisco, California, 67% of robberies in the first few months of this year have involved mobile devices. So if you're not familiar with SB 962, It's a California bill to mandate smartphones sold in the state come preloaded with anti-theft software and asks that device makers like Apple and Samsung put kill switch technology on every smartphone, which lets users lock the phone if it's stolen. Now, the bill applies only to smartphones manufactured after July 1st, 2015, not on other devices like tablets. Back in 2013, 3.1 million Americans were the victims of smartphone theft, which is nearly twice as many as in 2012, according to Consumer Reports. So a similar federal bill, the Smartphone Theft Prevention Act, was introduced into the U.S. Congress in February. It's still in committee. It's making its way through the legislative process. The bill had stalled in the past because of pushback from the wireless carrier industry over kill switch software, leaving phones vulnerable to hacking, and the question of who's to blame if a phone is sold without that software, which is a penalty ranging from $500 to $2,500. All right, coming up, if you had to guess which social media platform was getting its own TV show, which one would you pick? The answer may surprise you. But first, I am joined by Harrison Weber, news editor over at VentureBeat. Hey, Harrison.
Hey, how's it going?
Very well, thanks. Let's talk about transportation. Got an article on VentureBeat today titled, As Uber Battles 13 Lawsuits, Cabbies and State Agencies Are Out for Blood. What's happening?
It's a very complex situation, but essentially Uber, which is a, you know, at least in my own words, rather innovative and extremely fast-growing company, is facing attacks from all sides, from drivers, from state insurance agencies, and from, traditional transportation lobbyists. So essentially right now there are 13 active lawsuits by our count. There's at least 11 now state agencies speaking out, warning drivers against using services like Uber. And right now Uber is silent on the matter, or largely silent on the matter, because their head spokesperson recently departed.
Well, that's somewhat convenient. Now, it sounds like the taxi and limousine industry wants to, at least in part, focus on insurance coverage. So making the case to the public that if an Uber driver is behind the wheel, they don't have the kind of insurance that's going to protect you if something happens. Is that right?
Yeah, definitely. There are two lawsuits right now in the U.S. Again, by our count, there are two lawsuits related to insurance. And then at least 11 states have so far recommended drivers against using services like Uber because of this. So the center to this is the insurance gaps that Uber supposedly has. Now, their insurance policies did recently leak, but it's not quite clear, and they're not willing to comment on the quality of their insurance. So all we have right now is the kind of Uber opposition saying that their coverage is not enough.
So what about the regulation side of this? If Uber's expanding to more cities all the time, and they really have had a rapid expansion globally, then you've got Lyft, which is now competing with Uber on more of a black car level. You've got Sidecar. I mean, the transportation industry is exploding. But is it inevitable that they'll all be regulated like the taxi industry? And if so, can they survive?
I think it's certainly very... there's at least a high potential that something like that would happen. Uber entered knowingly into a space that has been regulated for over a century, and you know it's jumped right in, and at a small scale, they've kind of managed to secure kind of good relationships with local governments. But as they grow, and they're growing very aggressively, as we've reported many times over the past month, the odds are either. Even if they can eclipse a traditional transportation industry and become like a de facto standard for transportation, they're probably going to face increasing regulation, which could stifle their own innovation and investor interests. So one thing I want to add real quick to that is this is exactly what traditional cab and limousine companies are trying to do. They're trying to say, this isn't a level playing field anymore. We have all these regulations, Uber does not. And the whole goal is to basically over-regulate Uber, and we'll see what happens when that happens.
Obviously, on the municipal level, there are different rules depending on what city you're in. Seattle, New York, San Francisco, Uber has different levels of regulation in all of those cities. Then you've got London. When you get into the international level, it gets more complicated. So it's sort of a city-by-city, region-by-region situation. But if you If you had to make a guess, would you say that the taxi and limousine industry maybe becomes deregulated because, as you mentioned, Uber could be a new de facto way of transportation? How does this play out?
Honestly, right now we're at this, you know, one of the reasons why we wrote the report that went out today is because we're at this kind of this interesting point in which it could go in many different directions. And so, though I don't have a clear answer for that, what I do think will happen, just on a hunch, is there'll be something in between in which Uber will face, you know, as it grows and finds the success that it's fighting for, I would not be surprised if certain things started being regulated. It's the same thing that would happen, you know, if you got into a city cab in New York, there'll never be surge pricing. And arguably, that's for the consumer's benefit. And so I wouldn't be surprised if Uber kind of just traded some of its freedom for, you know, just to an end to the legal battles. I don't think they're there yet, though.
Harrison Weber is the newest editor over at VentureBeat. Thanks so much for joining us, Harrison. And tell folks where they can read more of what you write online.
Yes, of course. You can read me more on VentureBeat.com.
All right. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
Finally, Ad Age is reporting that Pinterest is getting its own TV series. Did you guess correctly? Well, at least it'll be the main inspiration for a new series on the FYI network called We're Moving In. FYI is a subsidiary network of A&E. The show will apparently follow housemates who will use Pinterest to give them ideas for how to design their new house. And in each episode, a couple or a family will create a shared Pinterest board to get their decorating process started. FYI has reportedly ordered 6 half-hour episodes of the series, and it's the first show to ever explicitly integrate creative direction from Pinterest. By tapping into the highly engaged Pinterest community, we're able to bring that same unique creativity to the series, says FYI's president in a statement to Ad Age. And that might sound silly, but have you ever guys seen Rich Kids of Beverly Hills? Lots of Instagram integration there. It's not a terrible show, actually. Yes, it is. That's it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. Subscribe at twit.tv/TN2 and write us at tn2@twit.tv with questions, comments, or feedback. Don't miss Tech News Today, tomorrow, and every weekday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. It's our morning show. I'm Sarah Lane. Thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.